Thanks, Richard. Thanks a lot for inviting me. So I'm going to talk about economic mechanism design for efficient operation and in particular resource allocation. So what I'm going to do is I'll start with a couple of motivating problems from networks, and these are problems of resource allocation among strategic players who have economic incentives. And then we'll see a particular resource allocation problem in a simple setting, and we'll see how we can design a game to solve it. And then we'll consider the same resource allocation problem, but in a more realistic environment, in a more realistic setting, and the problem comes much harder. And we'll see how we can design a game in that setting. And we'll see some its equivalent properties. And finally, I will briefly talk about some human-centered experiments that we conducted to evaluate how the games that we designed perform in the real world. Okay, so let me start with a caricature of the internet structure. So there are multiple domains, and each of these domains is owned and operated by an independent entity, each of whom is selfish, in the sense that it only cares how well or efficiently its own domain runs. But then, it's really their actions together which determines how this very complex system as a whole operates. And the key players here are the carriers, who own capacity on various links in the network. And then there are ISPs, the service providers, who like to buy or lease capacity on various links to construct networks and provide service to the end users. Now, each of the players here, so we're going to focus on these two. Each of these players is a strategic player, and whatever they do in their self-interest. And they have economic incentives. And so it's not necessary that the actions that they take with those actions, the network can still operate efficiently. And the question then is, how can we devise mechanisms such that even with these entities acting selfishly and strategically, in that we are trying to game the system, still end up achieving a given system objective? So that's the high level goal. So let me begin with a resource allocation problem at a very fine-grained user level. So this is the classical flow control problem. So let's say we have one link with capacity C, and there are two users, and these users have utility functions V1 and V2, and we'd like to allocate resources between these two users such that the sum of their utilities is maximized, subject to the capacity constraint. So this is a classical flow control problem. It has been looked at for the last many years. And now it was observed that in this context, the pricing signals could be used to decompose this flow optimization problem into a primal problem, which is solved by the users, and it will solve a problem solved by them. Okay. And then it was observed that one could think of TCP as performing exactly such an optimization, and this led to a fairly deep and detailed understanding of what TCP is doing. And a lot of people have contributed to this, including Richard. And so by now we have fairly good confidence that TCP performs very well, in a certain sense. But the focus in this talk is going to be slightly different. So here I'm going to focus on the resource cycle allocation problem at a different level, at the network level. And so think of this as, so let's say this is a caricature of the internet. So there are entities such as AT&T, NMCR, and Sprint. And these own capacity on various links. So let's say AT&T owns capacity on the various links. And depending on how much capacity it makes available, it incurs a certain cost. And then there are entities such as AOL and Comcast and Brooklink. And these would like to obtain capacity on various links to construct their routes and provide service to their end users. And depending on how much capacity they are able to acquire, the drivers are going to change. Now the thing here is that these cost functions and these utility functions are private information. Now from a system point of view, what we would like is to determine an allocation which maximizes what's called social welfare. Now, social welfare is the sum of the utility functions of the service providers minus the cost functions of the network. So that's the goal. So we'd like to determine an allocation which maximizes this social welfare. It could be a different, some other objective as well. But let's say that this is our objective. Now, the difficulty here is that the utility function and the cost functions are private. So they are not really known to the system. So then the question is, okay. So is it an intractable problem that we cannot solve, or can we find some way of solving such a problem? Okay. So let me, here's another very similar problem, but this is from in the context of wireless networks. So let's say we have a cellular network, and we have spectrum in each of these cells to be allocated among different entities. So we want to allocate the spectrum in the AT&T and similar and Sprint. Now each of these entities, they want spectrum in a bundle of cells, and they would like that these cells be contiguous, let's say, because they would like to provide contiguous coverage across the region. And depending on how much spectrum they are able to get and what cells they are able to acquire spectrum in, they derive a certain value. And again, the problem here is, can we find a mechanism that such that the spectrum that allocates the spectrum in such a way that the social welfare is maximized? And social welfare here is just the sum of the utility functions of the wireless networks. So same problem, slightly different, and maybe even a simpler setting. So this is just to give you a perspective that even though these two problems come from networks, but at an abstract level, this can be applied to any resource allocation problem. I mean, these are just general rules. So let's go back to our the first problem. So we want to consider a simpler setting first. And the setting here is that we only have service providers. We don't have the buyers who would like to buy bandwidth. We don't have the network operators. So all the network resources are owned by a single entity who would like to allocate these resources among various buyers. That's the setting. And furthermore, we are going to consider that there are L divisible goods, that each good is divisible, in the sense that if we have capacity C on a link, then any fraction of that can be allocated to any of the entities. So we're not going to constrain that capacity can only come in equal units of this functions. So this is the setting. And okay, so now if buyer I, so he wants some bundle RI, and this could be bundle of links which constitute a route. So if he gets XI units, and he makes a payment of WI units to acquire these XI units, then this is VR function. And we're going to assume that the utility function VR is nice, strictly invariant on A. This is the setting, and the social welfare function is, as I defined before, so it's just the sum of the utility functions of the various buyers. And the system objective is that we like to determine an allocation which maximizes the social welfare. But then as we discussed before, these utility functions are private information. The system doesn't know what these are. So then the question is, okay, what can we do about this? Okay. So what we could do is we could, let's say, have an option type system where the players, or where these entities, they are asked to give a signal representative of their true utility function. So these could be, they could be just asked to give a slope at a certain point, or this could be any bit signal. You have to find, we would like to find the right bit signal that we can use to determine allocation to achieve our objective. We'll come to that in a minute. So these buyers devote a bit signal which is a representative of their true utility function, and then the auction system takes this as input and it determines an allocation and certain prices and certain payments to be made by these players. Now a buyer's objective, each of these buyers is created, it has no reason give a truly representative signal of its true utility function. It could lie about it. And so its objective is really to pick a bit signal that maximizes its payoff. It doesn't care anything about social value. So the system and the buyer objectives need not be aligned. And then the question is, can we find an allocation function and a payment rule that these objectives become aligned and can achieve our system? Okay, so let me present a solution for this problem. So let's say that buyer submits some bits VR. This is a two-dimensional bit. And what it represents is that he is willing to pay beta dollars per unit up to DI units of some bundle R. And in the context of the network, this bundle will be a router. And so what the mechanism does is that it takes these bids and it maximizes sort of a pseudo social welfare subject to capacity and demand constraints. So it basically does this optimization and determines the output. So this is how the allocation is determined, and then the payments are determined according to this rule. And so if a buyer receives X, I, and R, then he gets this payment. And here, this particular term is the option allocation when a bidder I does not participate. So probably it will be more fruitful. So to show how this works through an example. So let me not go into detail. Let me show you an example and see how this is really working. Okay. So let's say we have 6 units of one good, and there are 3 buyers. And let's say there are 3 players. The red player makes a bid of $3 per unit, and he wants up to 3 units. The blue player makes a bid of $2 per unit, and asks for at most 2.5 units. And the green player says he's willing to pay $1 per unit for up to 4 units. So these are the bid signals. These may or may not be representative of their actual utility. So what the mechanism now does is that it has these bids, it has 6 units. It first considers the highest bid, which is the red player, and that only wants 3 units, so it allocates 3 units to that bidder. Now it's left with 3 units. The next highest bidder wants 2.5 units. It allocates 2.5 units to the blue player. And then it's left with 0.5 units, and that is allocated to the green player. So in a very simple setting, this is how the mechanism works. In a more complicated setting with multiple rules, things become much more complicated. Now the way the payments are determined is the following. So effectively, the payment rule that I specified before amounts to the following. So we look at the bid of the marginal player. The marginal player is the one whose bid is the last one to be accepted, who gets any positive allocation. And that kind of determines what the price can be. So here the marginal player is green and he bids $1 per unit, and that determines what the price will need to be paid by the other players. And so the red player pays three, the blue player pays 1.5, but the marginal player is not paying for this particular example. If there were another player who had not gotten any allocation, even though he had been something positive, then this player would have to make a positive payment. But for this example, it turns out that it does not have to make anything. Okay? So, another question is, okay, if these players are strategic, then what happens? What kind of outcome can we expect? What is the outcome actually? Is it profit or image? So let's think of that question now. So we're going to consider Nash equilibrium as our equilibrium concept, and that's the usual one. So it is a bid profile such that if all the other players are bidding according to this bid profile, then player I's payoff is maximized if he also uses the best offer. So it's the usual notion of math. And we'll say that a Nash equilibrium is efficient if the corresponding, if the social welfare and the corresponding allocation achieves the maximum. Now what we can show is that for this mechanism, there actually exists a Nash equilibrium, and furthermore, there exists a Nash equilibrium which is efficient. So even though the utility functions of these players is private information, we've been able to design a mechanism, a system, where these players make bids representative of their full utility function, and the system is able to determine the optimal application. So let me give you kind of a very quick idea of why this thing is working. So what's happening is that the way the payment rule is set up, the payment of player I only depends on the bids of the other players. So that's kind of the key. So once a player's payment only depends on the bids of the others, his incentive to manipulate the price, there's no incentive to manipulate the price. That's kind of what makes it work. So if you consider player 3, it turns out that fixing the bids of the other players, his payment function looks like the step function, where if he gets, let's say, x3, then he has to make this much money. And we're able to determine this because the payments are being determined by the bids of the other players. And this thing here is the marginal utility of player 3. First derivative of his function. And so now his problem is to pick a bid signal that maximizes his payoff. And that would be where the marginal utility equals the payment. And so this is kind of what is happening. And then once you observe this, one can establish that the branch multipliers for the auction optimization problem also turn out to be the branch multipliers for the social optimization. So at a kind of high level, that's what makes the thing work. Now, a natural question after this is, okay, is this a unique Nash equilibrium or the other Nash equilibrium? And it turns out that the Nash equilibrium is not unique, and there are many Nash equilibria, and not all of them are efficient. So this mechanism does have inefficient Nash equilibria. But some of those can be eliminated through a hack. So So you can introduce reserve prices. Where each winner pays not only the payment, but also he has also paid a reserve price. Okay, let me just, I don't want to get into in detail on this, but let me just mention that this problem has generated a lot of interest, and there's been a lot of work around this. And what I presented is, this actually belongs to, or related to a class of mechanism called the BCG method. And among this line of work, it's pretty closest to paper. I won't go into more detail than that. Let me go on to the next problem. So this was really a warm-up. So let's consider this one. So again, the setting is same. So we have a network, and there are carriers like AT&T and MCR who want capacity on various links, and depending on how much capacity they make available, there is a cost. And then there are service providers like AOL and Comcast who like to buy capacity on various links, construct their routes, and depending on how much capacity they are able to acquire, they derive a certain value. And these cost functions and these two functions are primary. Now, the twist from the previous problem is that we are going to consider the capacity or the load that we're considering to be invisible. That is, it only comes in discrete or integral. So this actually makes the problem much harder, because in the previous problem, you know, we had access to convex optimization and all the tools and techniques, and we could do all the work about matching the queries. But when you consider indivisible goods, that is not the case. The problem becomes much harder. And this is the realistic setting. I mean, in a real exchange, bandwidth is not traded, would not be traded in any fraction. I mean, it's traded in some basic limit. So let's say there are n buyers and n sellers, and the buyer I wants a bundle of goods Ri, and these could be links that constitute the route. And if he acquires Xi units and he makes a payment Tr, then he divides this. And similarly, seller J, if he's able to sell Yj and gets a payment Dj, then he says. This need not be true in general, but these pair of functions are what are called quasi-invisible. The actual pair of functions in general could be complex. I just want to point that out. I don't even need to get this kind of pair. Okay. Now, as we defined before, the social welfare is basically the sum of the utility functions of the buyers minus the cost, sum of the cost functions. You can also think of that as being a trading surplus. So this is the total value delivered to the service providers, and this is the total cost incurred by the network operator. In some sense, it is a trading surplus of social value. Okay. And again, our goal is, the goal of the system is to determine an allocation that maximizes the social welfare subject to flow constraints. That's the goal. But then, as before, the problem, the difficulty is that these utility functions and these cost functions are primary functions, and there's no way the system can determine the optimal allocation without knowing the utility functions and cost functions. So again, we could use an auction system which elicits some information from the players, from the buyers and the sellers, which are representative of their utility functions, two utility functions and two cost functions. And then we could use these bid signals to compute the allocation and the payments. Okay. And okay, so in this particular context, so let's see, so we'll take the bid signal to be the following. So with a buyer with, let's say, true value VI, makes a bid, which says that it's willing to pay up to VI dollars per unit for delta I units of some bundle of goods, RI, and these we route in an output. And a seller J says that he has two costs EJ, and he says that he wants at least $80 per unit, and he's willing to supply up to sigma J units for some link LJ. So these are the, this is how the bid signals look for this particular case. And now the mechanism takes these bids and it determines an allocation which maximizes surplus to actually pseudo trading surplus, it's not the actual trading surplus, because we don't know the actual utility function that cost. This objective simply depends on whatever has been revealed by the buyer, which need not be the true models. So we determine this allocation, which maximizes the trading surplus, a little bit of thing. And so this is how the allocation is determined. And now the way that we determine the price is the following. So we look at, for a particular link or a particular good, we look at all the sellers whose bids have been accepted. And we pick the highest bid among those as the price on that link. So we declare that to the price. And now a buyer who wants a route RI will simply pay sum of prices on the links in his route and times the quantity. And a seller would get, each seller is selling only one link. So we'll simply get this price times the quantity that is sold. So that's, those are the big bids. So this is, just maybe I should point it out. So this mechanism, the underlying philosophy of this mechanism is very different from the one before. There are difficulties with that. The main difficulty is that if you try to use that mechanism for this setting, you will not get budget balance. Budget balance in the sense that the sum of payments made by the buyers would be less than the sum of payments made to the sellers. Whereas the way this mechanism is designed, that is automatically guaranteed. So that is why for this setting we have to design this mechanism. Okay, so now it's probably not easy to understand what's really happening. So let me give a simple example. Okay. So let's say we have just one good or one link network, and we have three buyers, and they have two valuations, 3.1, 2.1, and 1.1 for 1 unit. So we'll only consider that case. We'll consider the case that each of these players wants only 1 unit, and each seller only 1 unit. And there are three sellers. And they have costs 1.3 for 1 unit. And let's just imagine, so these players are strategic, but let's just imagine that they actually bid their true valuations and their true costs. And so then the way the mechanism will work is the following. So first, it will consider the highest buy bid and the lowest sell bid, and if the surplus is positive, then those will be accepted. Then you can consider the next highest value, the next lowest sell rate, and if the surplus is positive, then those will be accepted. Then it considers the next highest value, the next lowest sell rate, so now the surplus is negative, so these bids are not accepted. So I'm not doing anything except I'm just doing that optimization. But that's what is happening. So, so in a simple one good case, this becomes like a matching problem. But when you have multiple goods, it's no longer a matching problem. It's a bit more complicated than that. So now what's happened here is that with these bids, the first two buyers and the first two seller bids are accepted. And the price, the way we defined it was, the highest ask price among the sellers whose bids have been accepted. And here we accepted the bids of sellers with costs 1 and 2, it bids 1 and 2, the highest number is 2, and this is the price. So Now, once we define this price, this is what the two winning buyers will pay. This is what the two winning sellers will get, even though the buy bids were actually more than $2. And
in the context of the networks, could you just explain what's the relationship between R's and L's?
Yeah, like I mentioned, so R actually is a bundle of loops. So in the context of network, it will be a bundle of links. It could be any bundle of links, but let's say these bundle of links actually form the physical bar.
So you need to know the physical route of every network operator?
No, so let's say these the buyer, so this is part of the specification, right? So the buyer says, this is what he's willing to pay and this is what he wants. The system doesn't need to
know that. If he wants a link around that, from Seattle to what he's going to say.
Yeah, okay, if you want end-to-end, well,
so that's what they care about.
You could say that there's some that. So you give it source and destination and it says, okay, you have these options, you can choose one. Right now this mechanism is doesn't have this mechanism, the way what I'm describing is not for any route. I mean, there are multiple routes between any source and destination.
But then you can find the prices on L's, and L's if I is the links of the network. And
right.
And so you are assuming that if, for example, the topology of the network of all networks are the same because we're comparing them to each other, right?
That's a very good question, but I mean, it could be that once the prices are known, that the sum of prices on one route and an alternative route may not be the same. It is possible. I haven't solved that problem yet. That's a much harder problem. So right now, I'm just going to assume that buyer just picks one route. It might be, I don't even know if that can be the case that for the same source destination route, there are different prices. I don't know that. But to assume that, yeah, the buyer specifies how to compute. So now here, in this example, we assume that the players, these players are, you know, they, when they bid, they are actually doing the true valuations and true costs, but they are strategic, and this need not be the case. And then the question is, okay, what will happen? So will this mechanism produce efficient allocation, or will it be inefficient, and if inefficient, how inefficient are those applications? How bad can they be? Okay, so let me, but before I get into equilibrium analysis, let me just give you just one slide snapshot of the two-way mechanism design. So we'll say that an auction mechanism is ex post individual rational. If the payoff at any equilibrium is non-negative for all participants. So what this means is that it is rational for every individual, every participant, to participate. Because then he's not going to lose. At least by participating, he's not going to lose. If we can end up with a negative payoff, then the mechanism does not have this property because he could have chosen not to participate. So this is the first property that we're. The second property is that it is efficient, and efficiency is typically taken to be maximization of social output. Though it need not be, and there can be other social choice functions, but we are considering here the sum of the GDP functions that we use. So in our context, efficiency will just mean that it maximizes the sum of the GDP functions. And we'll say that the mechanism is incentive compatible. If at equilibrium, it is a dominant strategy for all the distributors. Now what does that mean? That means that at equilibrium, it does not matter what the other agents are doing for each agent. The game is designed in such a way that it is dominant for each player to just truthfully reveal his true intuition function, because that is not affected by what comes in. So this is a very strong requirement, of course. But if we can have this, I mean, that would be the best property that we could get. Of course, it's a very, very strict requirement. And the last requirement is that the mechanism be budget balanced. That is, the sum of payments made should be zero. And this is particularly important in a case involving both buyers and sellers, because at the very least, we don't want it. We don't want that an external agency has to put in the money to make the system work. So it's a very critical requirement. So, one of the most well-known, and in fact, the only well-known mechanism is what's called the Dupuy-Clark-Rose mechanism. So this was originally proposed by Dupuy. We in fact got the Nobel Prize for this about 10 years ago. And so this class of mechanism, for those who know, the Dupuy mechanism is a generalization of the second price option. So the second price option is that, okay, if a house is being auctioned, then the house goes to the highest bidder, but he pays the second highest bid. So that's the second price option. And the VCG mechanisms are a generalization of that. I mean, generalization is fairly well generalized. So now it was, now it turns out that this class of mechanisms, they are incentive compatible, they are exposed to individual rational, they are efficient, they are non compliant. And again, surprising as it was, and I guess that is why I got the Nobel Prize, but these mechanisms had the incident compatibility problem. At equilibrium, it was a dominant strategy for each player to reveal its true visual function. However, it did not have the budget balance property, and that is a very critical requirement in the context that you're considering.
Why?
Because we have buyers and sellers, and if you are bringing a bank exchange, maybe you can do it surplus, but you definitely don't know it.
But you don't know if this is going to follow the other three criteria and if this is satisfied.
Sorry?
You do not know if that's more important than the other criteria. Why is it going to follow the
other three? No, it's not more important, but if a company wants to build a bandwidth exchange, then it's a very important requirement. It doesn't want to be.
Who's going to say?
Sorry?
Who's going to say?
Now, if it has to put in the money, then it would.
No, who's going to say?
Sorry?
Who's going to say?
No. But I mean, if suppose they implement a mechanism which is not budget balanced, then and they are doing the trading, and they might as well start
using. Who is going to check and what will happen?
Sorry.
Who is going to check and what?
Well, at the end of the year, if they look at their balance sheets, if they use the company, which is
that they don't have to disclose the buyers or all the information.
Well, typically, whenever you hold an auction, you have to review the rules of the game, and that's the definition.
Not all of them.
Sorry?
Not all of them. Not in this instance.
Well,
the three criteria satisfied with DC is much more important than the balance.
No, those are. I'm not saying those are not important. I mean, efficiency, of course, is very important. Individual rationality is also very important. One could say
IC
maybe
is very important.
IC is very important.
No, because otherwise you don't see.
Yeah, but if you can get efficiency and individual rationality and budget balance,
I can give you a very good example. We worked this out in the wireless networks for media access control. Okay? And there's no, we can talk about it, but there's no budget balance requirement.
No, I'm not saying this is a requirement for every application. I'm not saying that. Like in a wireless power control.
Having incentive compatible is very important, because if you don't have incentive compatible, people will try to
No, but as long as you have efficiency, I don't see. I mean, again, one needs incentive compatibility for many other reasons. One is information requirements become much easier, right? That's one of the key reasons why incentive compatibility is.
Let me ask you a different question. Do you think all these criteria need to be applied, for instance, in oil exchange? Oil market exchange? The reduction of capital? And again, I ask you because people ask these questions, how do you check? And then it says like this, but the balance is satisfied since you are not revealing information. You are not forced to reveal information. So qualitative is nice to know that you have it. There's no way anybody would put anyone in force. While all the other things everyone can check if they're satisfied.
No, if I compatibility is very hard to check, right? I mean, you make a bid, I have no way to check that whatever utility function you reveal is.
Don't have to say compatible people who don't follow the rules and they will think that they will find out that way that there's no incentive to collaborate. I'm asking a different question than what you have in your framework.
Right.
That's why it's important, very important, because you don't have mechanisms that people will really like to follow as far as what they concern from what they can see.
Right.
Now, checking budget balance, unless everybody declares okay, prices and what they pay, which is not happening, then the individual player will not know. You may say that
individual player may not know, but the auctioneer, this is what the auctioneer is. The auctioneer wants budget targets. He at least wants budget surplus. He doesn't want a budget cut, that is it. If he's running an oil exchange, he doesn't want to put in the money.
Yeah, I don't want to
That's the only point I'm trying to make here. Like you said, I mean, in many cases, the whole point of conducting using an auction-based system is you want to elicit true information. In which case, incentive compatibility is the most important part.
Right, but the mechanism also can be thought of as a way of negotiation.
Right.
In this case,
in that case, budget balance may not be.
In which case, the arbiter is not in the picture.
Exactly. I mean, typically, for most applications, incentive compatibility would be considered the most important part. Probably.
Please go ahead. I'm sorry to
Okay, so I guess I was mentioning that the VCG class of mechanisms has three of the four properties. But then the question is, okay, can we find a mechanism which has all the four properties? And it turns out that the famous impossibility theorem, we say that you cannot do that.
Because you can't get them with your biability.
Okay, so now the question is, okay, which of these four properties? Mechanism that I just described. Okay, so then let's go through the framework. So the payoff for a buyer is simply the per unit true value minus the per unit payment that he makes times the price. And for a seller, the payoff is simply the price per unit that he gets minus his per unit cost times the price. So that's just kind of that is the market for a seller. And given these payoff functions, so we consider a matching return, which will be the usual one. That it's a bid profile such that fixing that all the other players using the bids in the bid profile, a player payoff is maximized if he also uses the bid in the bid profile. So if you fix bids of the sellers to be this should be A star, and all the other bidders to be A star. And BI star's payoff is maximized. BI buyer's payoff is maximized if you also pick the BS. That's just a usual notion. Okay. And as before, we'll say that an attribute is sufficient if the corresponding allocation achieves the maximum. Now, question is, okay, what happens in that mechanism? So let's go back to our example. There were three sellers, and there was only one good, so let's just keep things simple. And the buyer valuations were, the true valuations were 3.1, 2.1, and 1.1. And let's say that's exactly what they did. And the seller true costs were 1, 2, and 3. And let's say that seller 1 and 3 bid exactly their true cost. But seller 2, whose true cost is 2, bids 2.1. So this is a candidate set of strategy. And let's see if this is an issue. Okay, so let's so with these bids, what will happen is that buyer 1 will be sort of matched with seller 1, these two bids will be accepted, and buyer 2 will be matched with seller 2. But buyer 3 and seller 3, since they together would result in negative surplus, those bids are not accepted. So the allocation is the same. And now the price is the highest asked price among matched sellers, among the sellers whose bids have been accepted. And the sellers whose bids have been accepted are 1 and 2. 2 bids, 2 and 1, that is the highest, and that is the price. So the price here is 2.1. This is what those two winning buyers will pay, and this is what the winning sellers will get. Okay? So this is the outcome, the option for these bids. So now let's check that into an Ash equilibrium. So let's consider buyer 1. So buyer 1, he has two valuations, 2.1, that's what he bids, but he pays 2.1. And so he has a surplus, he has a payoff of 1. And there's no way he can improve on this payoff. So if he deviates, let's say he tries to make the price go down by bidding too low, then it will end up happening that he doesn't get any allocation. So he has no incentive to deviate. So he's happy where he is. Now let's look at buyer 2. He bids 2.1 and he pays 2.1. So he has a net payoff of 0. And if he cannot change the price by bidding high, because the price is being determined by seller 2's bid. And if he bids too low, then his bid is not accepted. So let's say he prefers net payoff and getting something than not getting anything and payoff. Just within that. So he has no incentive to deviate as well. And buyer 3, so he bids 1.1 and he doesn't get anything. Now, if he wants something, he must bid above 2.1. But then he will have to pay 2.1, and he will end up with a negative payoff. So he also doesn't have any incentive to deviate. And now let's consider the sellers. Seller 1, he has a cost of 1, and but he's getting 2.1. Now, if he changes his bid up to 2.1, there will be no change in the allocation of the prices. If he bids above 2.1, then his bid won't be accepted anymore and he will get payoff. So he has no incentive to deviate. Let's consider seller 3 first. So he bids 3 and he does not get anything. Now if he wants his bid to be accepted, he must bid below 2.1. But in that case, he will end up getting a negative payoff. He's selling below 2. Now the interesting thing is seller 2. So seller 2, his true cost is 2. And he makes a bid of 2.1. If he bids just a bid above 2.1, then his bid is not accepted and payoff is 0. And if he decreases his bid, the price will change. The price will also increase. But then his payoff has decreased. So his payoff is maximized if he exactly bids 2.1. So this is a natural problem. And as we saw before, the allocation in this case is exactly the 1, which is if they were to bid quickly and it would be efficient. So even though this is very simple, like 3 only 3 bar 3 seller 1 door, but actually can be generalized to arbitrary number of buyers and sellers and also arbitrary number of. It actually is, I mean, that's not as simple as a single loop case. And moreover, so here I describe only one attribute. And then again the question is an attribute in green? But it turns out that actually it is not. There are many attributes. But what we can show is that every attribute allocation is efficient. I do have to qualify that, because there are bad attributes. But it turns out that you can eliminate them. You can do what's called iterative elimination of combinated strategies. And so if you allow, if the players only use rationalized labor strategies, then it turns out that all these are the natural equilibrium. And the standard equilibrium elimination Indian food. So, okay. Now, as we discussed before, this mechanism by design is well balanced and it's exposed into individual rational. And moreover, we saw one Nash equilibrium where all players except one player, in this case, it's true. So it's not infinitely compatible because there is, for at least for this simple case, there is one player who is not truthful. But in a very weak sense, it's almost infinitely compatible. I mean, you can't get all four properties anyway. So, but we considered the, for this problem at least, it seemed that the first three properties, the other three properties are more important than the compatibility. And this mechanism has the properties. So, yeah, some.
The highest mass seller means the seller with the highest price that has been accepted by the dealer, right?
Right.
So this cannot cause any incentive for people to start playing games around the seller because he doesn't, he's not incentive compatible?
It is not incentive compatible.
So he's not?
No. Right. So see, the interesting thing, the way this mechanism is designed is you have completely taken a kind of a strategic play from the buyer side.
So again, sorry.
You have taken some incentive away from the buyers to gain this. Because the price is determined by the seller price.
Right.
That is what, I mean, kind of makes this possible. Otherwise, it wouldn't work. And there are other similar ideas, but they don't work. I mean, they have problems. Now, one thing I guess I should point out here, that what we have seen is this is a full information map. So I assume that players know true values and true costs of everybody. But that is not the case. I mean, predicting an option is not a material case. So in that case, we really have to consider a setting where the players don't know the true valuations and costs of others, but maybe know the distribution from this data. And in that case, we have to consider, in that case, a player would be maximizing, taking a bid to maximize his payoff, but taking a bid to maximize his expected payoff. So if you look at Bayesian Nash equilibrium,
but, okay. Another question. The players don't, may or may not know the information, but do they know the rules?
Well, rules are everybody knows.
That's what it is.
Actually, I mean, what you are saying is, I mean, that's another line of work.
Exactly. Another variation of this whole problem where when I'm trying to negotiate, I cannot even assume that we both have the same model.
Right. So one variation of this would be that the auction designer is himself a player in the game. So he gets to set the rules, but he can try to maximize, I mean, he has his own objective. But we're not considering that. I mean, that's not part of our allocation here. Okay, so so the framework here is that, so now we're going to look at the Nash equilibrium. We're going to consider strategies, which are like, you will consider that all the sellers use the same strategy function. So what that means is if a seller's cost is, true cost is C, then he will pay some alpha. So there's some common function alpha. This need not be true in general. But let's cost to that. All symmetric here means, so we'll consider symmetric equilibrium corresponding to such strategy space. And moreover, we'll assume, we'll consider those strategies such that a seller always bids at least his true cost. He doesn't bid below his cost. We'll assume that. And we'll assume that a buyer doesn't bid above his true value. So these are the strategies. These are our strategies. Okay. And so we call these exposed individual rational. So the implication is that players are risk averse. And they, even if there is a, in an expected sense, they might win, but the fact that there is a non-zero probability and they have a negative payoff, So they don't want that. Okay, now the question is, okay, does a Bayesian Nash equilibrium exist and is it efficient? Okay, and now in fact one can show that a Bayesian Nash does exist in the corresponding game. And moreover, any symmetric Bayesian Nash equilibrium actually converges to the truth-telling strategies as n goes to infinity, as the number of players goes to infinity. So the truth, back to client strategy means that if a seller's cost is C, then you get C. That alpha function and beta function has become medium. That's what alpha prime and beta prime. And as I mentioned before, this mechanism by design is very balanced. And so this is, the mechanism is asymptotically, so it's not in general Bayesian incentive compatible, but asymptotically it becomes a Bayesian incentive compatible. And it asymptotically becomes Bayesian. So I'm not going to go into this.
Since you were looking at the social cost, why didn't you average with respect to V in the previous expression?
Which one?
You had conditional expectation, conditional every V, right? The, the third item there.
This one?
Yeah.
Oh, this is just saying that he will. So this is this payoff function.
Right.
And given he knows is true, I mean, that's all. It shouldn't even be there actually. It's a parameter.
Is that what you were asking? Yeah.
Yeah. This expectation is over the distribution of all the other sellers and all the other
That's fine.
Okay. Now,
so in this case, what everybody knows?
Sorry?
What do I know? Every player knows?
Every player knows the rules.
Yes.
And they know the distribution from which the costs come.
Of all the others. Distribution of the cost.
Right. And distribution of the valuation.
All the others.
Right. And here I assume the same, but actually in the paper, I mean, it's very simple.
Right.
And I have different assumptions. So now all these, you know, my theoretical results, I mean, I have to exercise your brain a little bit, and they are nice, but the question is, okay, how well will such a mechanism work? Will it work in the real world? Or are these just theoretical results? So to test that, we actually implemented this mechanism. So we implemented the system, and we had a web-based interface. And then we had students participate in an experiment. And our assumption was that the students are more rational than others. So we told the students we told them what their retrieval functions are and what the cost functions are. And they were told the rules of the game, and they were not allowed to communicate. And they were told, okay, this is the distribution from which the valuation and cost come. All this information was given. And then we conducted a series of experiments. And so what we found was that it seemed to work fairly well. That could be debatable, I mean, what is well, but we got about 80% efficiency on average. And that's just with four players on each side. I mean, that's just with, there were four buyers and four sellers, and there was increasing information. And the asymptotic efficiency result, I mean, that is for most of them. So we, at least in a controlled environment, it seemed to work really well. Okay. So let me summarize. So network pricing ideas, they have proved very instrumental in network performance and control analysis. But I think some of the existing problems in networks, particularly those that we have in data centers, and most of the problems that we are facing in network theory now do involve in data centers. I think we really have to look at game theory techniques and mechanism design to solve the problems. And so I introduced two pricing mechanisms. So one was a mechanism for allocating divisible goods, and the other one was a mechanism for divisible goods, both buyers and sellers. And as you saw, this mechanism achieves the balanced, and the expression is rational. And I guess, as far as I know, I mean, this is known to be a fairly hard problem, particularly in a combinatorial context. It's a very hard problem. There's individual goals and multiple goals, and particularly if you want better balance. As far as I know, there is, I don't know if any other connection first for the first problem or the second problem? Actually, if you go out, if you consider functions other than quasi-linear, things become, there are very few results. Quasi-linearity is the minimum that you need. And it's not assuming a lot, right? It's basically, when you say you have quasi-linear preferences, you are basically saying that the units on which you measure money and the units in which you measure non-monetary utility, right, is the same. That's all you're saying.
Right.
So I think it's not a big assumption.
If your prices and in other words, if the seller asks you back, or you go to buy, or you go to buy,